Both countries trusted each other. There were no bilateral issues at any time during our last 65 years. So it's I can say it's a model partnership between a big country and a small country.
Let's not mention the size. Yeah. All countries are equal on the international stage. But can you give us some perspectives, please, as to how important China is for Sri Lanka in terms of business and trade development, and how Sri Lanka is to China as well?
China is the now second largest economy in the world. Traditionally, we were targeting our export to the Europe and the United States. But now the growing market here in China is becoming very important. And more than our export, the more imports are coming from People's Republic of China to our country. It's a day by day, it's a growing. Sri Lanka, again, though I don't want to mention the size, but our economy is only $82 billion economy. But nevertheless, our trade turnover between our two countries are $4 billion. That is much in favor of the trade balances people for China. But the Chinese tourists who go to Sri Lanka, China's investment which come to Sri Lanka is balancing this trade gap to make it a win-win situation to both countries.
Although you keep mentioning the size of Sri Lanka, I have been to Sri Lanka, wonderful country, very hospitable people, so I had a very good impression of that country. Although, you know, the size of Sri Lanka maybe is much smaller compared to China, but strategically, Sri Lanka is at a very important point. I mean, it's almost in the middle of the ancient maritime Silk Road linking Eurasian area, and is also very important on China's map of the 21st century maritime Silk Road. Some people, however, seem not to only grasp part of the concept. Some people say it's a set of values, some people say it's a symbol, other people say it's a tool of geopolitics. So besides infrastructure connectivity, which most people understand, I believe, by now, what is One Belt, One Road for you?
We have a very important role to play. Same time, we understand we would not be able to discharge our commitment, our responsibility to the international community without the cooperation of the rest of the world. Because we feel that being a non-aligned country, and strategically located, we must use this opportunity for our prosperity, for the well-being of our people. Same time, we must cooperate with the rest of the world. Therefore, so far, whether we are friendly with India, or whether we are friendly with the United States, or whether we are friendly with the rest of South Asia, and it has not affected to our relationship with China, or Japan, or Korea, or the ASEAN countries.
Are you worried in the future? I mean, if you have a closer economic relationship as the One Belt, One Road goes further, do you see any problem down the line?
I do not think at all. We, as an independent country, even when we entered the Rystrup Agreement in 1952, some of the Western countries were not happy. But being an independent, sovereign country, our leaders took that decision, going to a trade agreement with China. So even in the future, we would be able to do so same thing, because our history is known to everybody. We have nothing to hide, because we don't have any political ambitions to govern the region or to make a big power. We know our size, we know our responsibilities, we know the present world order. So we have a limited role. That role, of course, while maintaining our sovereignty, our dignity, we are prepared to work with everybody within the region, outside the region.
I think China fully respects these rules. At the same time, Sri Lanka has expressed its goal of building itself into an economic hub of the Indian Ocean. What is the consideration behind this goal, and how do you think working with China along the One Belt, One Road initiative can help Sri Lanka achieve that goal?
Because our resources are limited. Even our manpower, our total labor force is only about 8 million. So we would be not able to go into all the segments of economies. So we feel that our role would be to become a service and logistic hub in the Indian Ocean. Therefore, for for a People's Republic of China, second largest economy in the world. They have a huge export volume, which will go to Europe, it will go to Africa, emerging Africa, even to our South Asia, our part of the world. Similarly, many imports are coming to China. China has helped us to build our infrastructure, the seaport and airport and even expressways. So when that newer country has assisted us to build our infrastructure, it is our duty to cooperate with you, to allow you to use those facilities for you again.
China's investment in the Kuala Lumpur port city, which was a major project, we understand that in 2015 it was suspended for the accused lack of transparency. We do not know the exact story there, but it resumed in 2016. How do you look at this process and what lessons do you think can be drawn from there for both sides?
It's not from the Chinese investors' problem. The government which was in power at that time, this matter was raised in parliament, requesting to table all the conditions and the future plan. Unfortunately, none of these conditions or the future plan for the port city were not announced. So people were wondering, not only within the Sri Lanka, even within the region, many were raising question. What the envisaged target of this port city? Now, after that suspension, during that period, both parties sit together, they negotiated. A new government decided to make it a financial city, international financial city. Mm-hmm. Then to identify zone-wise what the amount of the land given to the investor for the public utilities, for the financial center. Now everything has been transparently negotiated with both countries, with the blessings of the political leadership of both countries. Now everything is on plan. So we are very happy that if anybody to learn a lesson, any country, the lesson is whatever we do internationally, we have to make it very transparent.
Now, we are going to hold this One Belt, One Road Forum, which is a highlight of China's diplomacy this year. There are all kinds of discussions going on as to how to better promote this initiative so that really more countries will understand this initiative and think about joining this initiative. What do you think can be done in this regard so that really this initiative can be translated into sustainable action and bring deliverables to the people along these lines or routes?
This project so far known as a Chinese project, but I think from the May onwards it will become a collective project. In fact, as I mentioned, Sri Lanka has played a very, I don't want to say the other countries are not so important, but Sri Lanka's strategic location has given a very significant role for us to make it a very effective transit point. Sri Lanka is prepared to do its job because we know that joining that initiative, we would be able to uplift our economy, we would be able to give a better living standard to our people.